Welcome back, geology fans. The fact this planet is over 70% covered with water leads us to think it must play a major role in rock formation at the Earth's surface. Indeed, almost half the minerals on Earth would not exist without water, and water makes both the principal agent of erosion and place of deposition on this planet. Certainly, today's rock group would not exist without water. The chemical sedimentary rocks form when various minerals come out of an aqueous solution. In a sense, this will be an easy episode, as the characteristics used to identify the chemical sedimentary rocks are simply the physical properties of the one mineral that is dropping out at a time. We start with halite, which precipitates out to form rock salt. As we have discussed the properties of halite and sylvite in the halide minerals episode, I won't belabor these easily identified minerals that make up rock salt and rock sylvite, respectively. Similarly, when gypsum or anhydrite are precipitating out, they make rock gypsum and rock anhydrite, respectively, and their properties were discussed in the sulfate minerals episode. All these monomineralic rocks are formed from evaporite minerals, and so are associated with areas of high evaporation. The best settings for these rock types are from closed basins, meaning a basin with water inputs but no outflows. Evaporation is enhanced with higher atmospheric temperature and lower humidity, so closed basins around 30 degrees north and south latitude have the greatest potential of making these types of evaporite rocks. The Mediterranean Sea has most of these qualities already, but has in the past had one more quality that made it perfect for making evaporite minerals. Around 6 million years ago, the water passage between the Mediterranean and Atlantic, the proto-Straits of Gibraltar, closed up due to tectonic forces cutting off Atlantic water from entering the Mediterranean basin, where the air above the sea was hot and dry and causing high evaporation rates. With no new water flowing in, the Mediterranean slowly evaporated away. But how do we know this? We know from the chemically precipitated sedimentary rocks at the bottom of that sea. When the Mediterranean basin is full, the dominant sediment is silica-rich clastic sediments, given the shorthand term siliciclastics, which we will meet in the next episode on clastic rocks. But as the Straits of Gibraltar closed and the Mediterranean Sea began to evaporate and concentrate its dissolved components, rock salt dropped out first, and then some sylvite may come out, and then gypsum on top of that, and then finally anhydrite as the sea came near to complete evaporation. Halite, sylvite, gypsum, and anhydrite, in that order, tells the story of a body of water with common dissolved ions continuously evaporating away. Of course, when the straits opened up again, it must have formed one of the most awesome waterfalls the world has ever seen as the Atlantic waters refilled the Mediterranean. But here is one more catch. We don't find one sequence of rock salt, gypsum, rock anhydrite. We find several of these sequences, indicating multiple near and complete evaporation events followed by basin refilling. Hopefully this dramatic event will help remind you that if you find rock salt, gypsum, or anhydrite, you should begin to think of evaporative environments where water can concentrate dissolved ions. But so far, we have only seen water precipitate halide and sulfate minerals. What about the most abundant mineral type of all, silicates? Agates, geodes, and concretions are examples of silica dropping out of solution. But unlike many of our other chemical sedimentary rocks, silica deposition is less common at the surface and more common underground, with groundwater reaching an area of rock or soil with the right chemical conditions to drop the silica out. This usually involves oxidation reduction chemistry conditions, allowing the silica to become relatively mobile and then immobile. The same is true for iron oxides that can deposit underground. Often the reduction condition is produced by organic materials, so concretions are often one of the places we will likely find fossils. Find a concretion, pop it open. Maybe you get a solid mass. Maybe you get a geode. Maybe you get fossils. But in all cases, we see monomineralic deposition in the rock that is not too recrystallized, and is often, though not always, microcrystalline or cryptocrystalline, meaning the crystals are too small to see. So, we have finally seen the fossils promised in our sedimentary rocks, and our next chemical sedimentary rock is also a great candidate for fossils, large and small. Limestone is the name of the chemically precipitated rock made of my favorite mineral, calcite. In fact, I grew up in Austin chalk limestone, which was exposed in the creek beds where my love of geology began. Some organisms are very good at precipitating calcite from water, and so the shells and skeletons of various organisms are made of calcite or aragonite, or get replaced by it. And even algae can precipitate limestone, as in the case of this limestone algal mat. The biggest producer of skeletal limestone is, however, plankton. Then again, limestone can come out of solution with no living organisms involved at all. With all the ways limestone can form, we have a wide variety of names for limestone. Reefal limestone and coquina are made of large reef-building skeletons and shells, respectively. Micritic limestone has all the calcite grains smaller than sand-sized. Oolitic limestone are made of spherically layered grains, and crystalline limestone is made of recrystallized calcite. This recrystallization is not so far as to take us into the metamorphic realms, but it is in the range of what we call diagenesis. Diagenesis, which happens in all sedimentary rocks, is a term for the changes that a sediment undergoes after deposition, and include the previously mentioned processes of compaction, cementation, and recrystallization, but further involves dissolution, polymorphic changes, meaning keeping the same chemistry but changing crystal patterns, or full-on replacement of one mineral for another. Some of these processes are more important in some sedimentary rock types than others, and limestone, being made of soft and soluble calcite, dissolution becomes pretty important in the limestones, and we'll meet some of the consequences of this in the large-scale sedimentary features episode. But with all this complexity, let's make it simple and say that if you find a rock that effervesces in hydrochloric acid, and it does not have a sugary recrystallized texture, and it might have some fossils in it too, then it's a limestone. A limestone of one of those various varieties mentioned. If it does have a sugary recrystallized texture, it is marble, which we'll meet in the metamorphic rocks. Because calcite can accumulate magnesium to become dolomite, some rocks will effervesce weakly with hydrochloric acid and are called dolostone. Limestone and dolostone are the two most common rock types to make solution caves and their decorative stalactites and stalagmites. Some of the less common chemically precipitated sedimentary rocks include phosphates, which have abundant apatite. Sitting in a realm where igneous touches sedimentary, we see hot springs bringing heated water with dissolved minerals and gases to the surface, and as that water degasses CO2 and cools, precipitation of the solution forms a solid, spongy mass called travertine. I say spongy, not meaning you can squeeze it or soak up water with it, but that it's full of holes and in some cases even worm-like tubes. Mammoth Hot Springs in Yellowstone National Park is one of the more famous travertine deposits in the world, and its pools are host to extremophile bacteria, which we will meet again in a much later episode when we properly cover the biosphere. Now, if we say that this travertine sits at the boundary of igneous and sedimentary, then where do we pigeonhole the hydrothermal deposits of sulfides, halides, and native elements? I saved mention of them until here, as technically we are seeing a chemical precipitate out of water, but this is one case where we don't need to be at or near the surface of the Earth to do so, and are closely associated with magma bodies that supply the heated fluids, so we might say that they sit more in the igneous box. But hydrothermal deposits also sit in the border of metamorphic, as the hot fluids allow transformation of many minerals in the solid state. So if you haven't caught my saying this enough, nature doesn't like to be pigeonholed. We humans make the conceptual boxes in which to put them, but this is for convenience and efficiency. Hydrothermal gaily mocks at the most ingenious setup box. And with that reminder, we wrap up our chemical sedimentary rocks, but recall that there is another main box we put the sedimentary rocks into. When we come back next time, we will see what the world makes of clastic sedimentary rocks and their lovely name boxes here on Earth Explorations.